Meet Charles Marshall, evolutionary biologist, paleontologist at the University of California at Berkeley, and he's the director of the museum here. This is the website of the University of California Museum of Paleontology. He's also someone who's promoted the use of putting fossils online and creating a paleobiology database. And here's an example of one of his papers, Marine Diversity Dynamics Over Deep Time. How do genera do as a function of time? Let's hear what he has to say. Are we alone?
No.
What do you mean by the word we?
Well, there's an awful lot of us on this planet. So in that sense, we're not even close to being alone.
Now, in astrobiology, we're very concerned about what kind of life would be elsewhere.
Yes.
And Simon Conway Morris and many astrobiologists think that if there's an aspect of life that has evolved independently multiple times on Earth, that becomes a good candidate for what we should expect elsewhere. What do you think of that logic?
Yeah, I think it's incomplete.
In what sense?
In the sense, so if you argue that I see the evolution of, say, a particular metabolism 100 different times independently, also let's take C3 or C4, C4 or CAM plants. Now, it looks like that's evolved multiple times from a C3 ancestry. So that looks like...
Would you do multiple times independently?
Yes, multiple independently. From a C3 plant, the CAM metabolism or the C4 metabolism seems to have evolved independently multiple times. Now, whether there's a deep homology there that makes that a little bit seem a little bit like a cheat, maybe that's true.
That's what I would argue.
Right. But it's possible it isn't, because the chemistry in the end is fairly simple. So... in that case, the argument seems reasonably good that that seems easy to evolve. If you only see something evolve once, doesn't mean that it isn't easy to evolve.
Is the thing that allowed us to have technology species-specific, or is there some more generic niche?
Right, and so I guess my answer to you, there is a more generic niche. Going back to one of the arguments I made in my talk back there, is I see the same thing often happening over and over and over again in evolution, and while every species is unique, a lot of their capacities and the relationships and the capacities are not unique. Mm-hmm. And so that's where humans are odd, because I think we crossed this threshold where if we go back 2 million years, we wouldn't have identified ourselves as being particularly special. Mm-hmm. I don't think. And yet we did cross this line somehow, this capacity, and it was an iterative process, and it's not a line, it's a blurry region where you come out the other end from 2 million years and you go, what the heck? Telescopes.
And are we alone?
No.
Why do you say that?
Because I think the universe is vast, just the size of the universe. I don't know what the probability I'd put in. I don't know whether it's 0.99 or 0.95 or 0.7.
And by alone, you mean whether there'll be other types of, any type of life?
So I think life is fairly easy to evolve.
I see.
And so I suspect that life, the universe is teeming with life.
Now, most people who I've talked to don't care about whether there's life elsewhere. They care about whether there's sentient life or conscious life or godlike life. We're going to answer their questions. And
oh, I see. So oh, so they're clearly not biologists or paleontologists.
Right. Most people are not biologists.
Yeah, I see. Are we alone in that sense? Wow. I don't know.